Mr. Ken, it looks like we have a new toy.
Yes, we do. This is a Space Shuttle Teleprinter. They used this on the Space Shuttle so they could send text up to the shuttle and print it for the astronauts.
Hello and welcome back. Yes, you heard it right. This is a teletype and it comes from the Space Shuttle. That Space Shuttle, the monstrously big space plane that went up in space and glided back down and lifted up the Hubble telescope and the core pieces of the space station. And apparently, it also lifted a big, heavy Navy Bodo teletype while it was at it. You know, a Navy teletype, the successor to one of these, which we lovely repaired in another series. What gives? These antique pieces of mechanical communication equipment, dating back from the 1940s, are well known for their robustness, but for crying out loud, they were not known for being fast nor light. I was first made aware of the existence of a shuttle teleprinter when one of them appeared for sale on RR Auction, the place where I got my Soyuz clock and my Apollo CTE, while I let big boys like Steve Jurvetson and Marcel fight for the more serious stuff. Honestly, I first thought that this teleprinter was a hoax, but no, it's all too real. The Space Shuttle did in fact carry a Navy mechanical teleprinter in space for its first 10 years of operation. And collector Marcel surprised us one day after he finally snatched this one on his third try. Oh boy, thanks Marcel for entrusting us with this one, and let's try to reverse engineer it and make it work again. So there was a teletype in the Space Shuttle.
Well, it was only the printer, not the keyboard.
It was half a teletype in the Space Shuttle.
So this was originally a Navy teleprinter along with a keyboard. And being from the Navy, it's extremely heavy, like probably 60 pounds.
It's unbelievably heavy.
All right. It's a piece of cake with two people.
And so this piece of lightweight equipment weighs 52.8 pounds. For us kilogram lovers, 24 kilograms.
So based on the shuttle's cost of flight, this cost $1.5 million to fly every time.
Why did you choose something so heavy? Okay, let's weigh down. Yeah. So we already cleaned it up quite a bit.
It was kind of a mess when it came in.
So, and here is the inside. It has the ribbon, the printer assembly, and you can tell how it works.
Yeah, it's not what you'd expect. It's a rotating drum that has all the characters on it. So it's basically a line printer with a hammer for every position.
It has hammers and it has a big rotating drum, and you see a few of the characters. So it rotates and the hammer fires just at the right time when the right character is in front of it.
So much faster than your typical one character at a time teletype. So it has four boards of complicated electronics, much more than you'd expect. It has a 6800 processor that controls it. It has a lot of memory, so you can buffer about 10 pages of data. There's a communications board. So it's much more complicated than you'd expect for just a printer.
Some of our most seasoned viewers must have recognized the inside of this device by now. It is made from the guts of a military AN-UGC-74 tactical teletype. It was a portable field unit, but weighing in at 100 pounds, only the military would call it portable. It was a relatively fast machine, for a mechanical teletype that is, with a max speed of, wait for it, 1200 bauds. Yes, 1.2 kilobits per second. That blazing speed was possible because the printer was assisted by an early microprocessor. The printing mechanism consisted of an 80-column drum rotating at constant speed and 80 hammers, one for each column. The microprocessor fired each hammer at the proper time when the correct character flew underneath it. But still, the mind boggles. Why would one choose such a clunky and heavy mechanism when light and fast electrostatic and thermal printers were surely available by 1980? Like the TI Silent from 1972, only 25 pounds. We were confused by that choice too, until Master Ken, after months of searching, finally went to the Library of Congress himself to find the one document that would tell us the convoluted story behind this very odd choice. First of all, it wasn't planned that way at all. NASA required a way for the shuttle astronauts to print long sheets of uploaded instructions. For that, the shuttle was supposed to use the new TDRS satellite for high-speed communications. But TDRS was delayed even more than the shuttle was, if you can believe it. So, with just 7 months to go before the first launch of STS-1, panic set in, and NASA frantically looked for an interim solution, the Shuttle Interim Teleprinter. Because of the time constraints, this had to start from an off-the-shelf solution. Ken's document tells us that the electrostatic and thermal printers were dismissed right off the bat, because of the flammability and toxicity of the special paper they used. This was completely unacceptable for spaceflight since the Apollo 1 accident. So the search was limited to impact printers that could print on regular paper, and even that would require a waiver. Speed was also important, as without the TDRS satellite, uploads from the ground were limited to 10-minute windows. So the Honeywell AN UGC-74 was selected because of its 1200 baud speed and its proven reliability. That thing could sure be shaken and stirred. And they lightened it up by removing the keyboard, the case, most of the AC power supply, and carving up the frame. That's how they proudly ended up with a featherlight 59-pound space teletype. They apparently also made some electronic modifications, but fortunately, we have Master Ken on hand to figure them out.
For the space shuttle, they took off the keyboard, and then they added three more boards of circuitry so they could send up FSK data.
Uh-huh.
So I found some documentation on the Navy half of it, but I'm still trying to figure out, reverse engineer, what the space shuttle specific boards are doing.
There's a few things that already were wrong. We can't load the paper because the roller is here. See if I can get this one out. And those basically have melted away.
And it was soaked up by the paper.
Yeah, I didn't take a picture. Actually, we can get a picture from the auction. There was, the rubber went into the paper. So it was quite hard to take the paper out.
Yeah, it looked like you had mopped up grease with the paper.
Yeah, and let me see if I can remove the shield so I can show you the drum is pretty impressive. Mm-hmm. I removed the screws for the shield here, and you can see the drum with all the characters in it. Right here. So this thing rotates, and the hammer on the other side will just hit the right character at the right time, which is why you need the microprocessor control, I guess. And here, over on the side, we have the motor with a temperature strip on it. And that's because the thing apparently can't stay on more than 90 seconds, so it overheats, overheats.
Well, I think it's about 10 minutes, but yeah, it has, you know, it's not designed for long-term use. I don't know if that's the space shuttle specifically because they didn't have, you know, air, didn't have cooling, or I don't know if the Navy model had the same problem.
That must be just the space shuttle because it was in a cubby or something like that. I can't imagine they wouldn't run them 24/7 in a ship. The story behind the 10 minutes max run time is explained in Ken's document. Because they only had space for the teleprinter in the mid-deck, it had to be silent since the astronauts slept there. But the teleprinter is very loud at 82 dB of noise pressure. So they decided to put it in a locker lined with soundproofing, which immediately caused another problem, overheating. So they simply added an auto-on, auto-off feature that would shut off the thing after 10 minutes. Since that was the time duration of a ground station pass anyhow, this crude solution worked. and there is another motor, and well, we don't see it. There's another motor with another strip. Actually, if I turn it around again, we'll see it. It's just monstrous. So we can see the extra motor with the extra temperature strip right here. But it has been modified by NASA, and the cage here is had bores that you've taken out to reverse engineer it because they have not been documented.
So yeah, I've been reverse engineering them. This board has a crystal, and then it divides the megahertz signal down with various divider chips to generate baud rate signals and other timing signals. This board has a 12 volt and 5 volt power supply, and that has some op-amp circuits probably to decode the FSK signals. And then this one takes a current loop signal, creates a voltage across these resistors, then amplifies it, and then has some filters, presumably bandpass filters, to pull out the correct FSK frequencies.
Right,
and again, it's all discrete with op-amps.
All right. One last explanation here. Since they did not have the satellite digital link, they had to transfer the data over an auxiliary audio channel they had left. For that, they used the FSK technique that Ken is talking about. It stands for frequency shift keying, and it's a mouthful to simply say that they use two audio tones, one for zeros and one for ones. It's an age-old technique used for radio teletypes and leads to this characteristic tone. A pleasant find when you encounter them in ham radio. But traditional radio teletype is very slow at 45.5 bauds. They wanted to go faster and eventually managed to eke out 600 bauds from the audio link by going to higher pitch, widely separated tones. As you'll see later, these non-standard NASA FSK frequencies are ear grating. Okay. I'm sending something.
Okay, this one's to sleep.
Okay. Sounds like an awful noise to me. But let's go back to Ken's reverse engineering.
These boards have been fairly modified. You can see a wire here. And then they just sort of soldered in some capacitors semi-randomly, which makes me think that perhaps this is a prototype. So the processing boards are all conformal coded and have mysterious military part numbers. But these boards are not conformal coded, and they have mostly commercial part numbers.
Okay.
Which also leads me to believe it's a prototype.
And then the connectors have been modified too. It's not what you expect from the Navy documentation.
So yeah, they have a big connector here that was used for power, and on the Navy it could take 28 volts DC. It could take 115, 230 volts AC, 50, 60, 400 hertz. It could basically take whatever power you wanted to throw at it. For the space shuttle, they repurposed it, and this connector is now used for the data input. So it's a good thing we realized that before we powered it up, because it no longer takes the power that is documented.
Moments later.
You guys have nice glasses. Are you feeling something?
So we have the space shuttle printer and its power supply. We want to make sure the power supply gives the right voltages before we blow up all the boards. We're going to check the voltages, and if they're right, then we can plug the boards back in.
It does not have any current.
It needs the relay. There we go.
Oh, we hit the current limit.
Okay.
Let's increase that a little bit. Try again. It works. We're going to move to the next voltage. 12.2 volts.
All right.
And that's the so-called negative 12.
Yeah, it's actually plus 12. Mm. The schematic is badly wrong.
Yeah, that's what I figured.
4.8. Minus 6.8 volts.
So is that the minus 8.6?
Yeah, that doesn't sound right. Plus 8.6 is correct. So that's 124.5 volts.
That's for the lamps, it seems reasonable. The minus 8.6 seems a little weak.
Well, we could try increasing the voltage a little bit. Yeah, minus 7 volts now.
You know, it may be not really regulated. Yeah, it's just from a...
Oh, it's a tap off that transformer.
Yeah.
But so it's going to be completely unregulated.
Yes, so I think we're good.
More moments later.
So for the next experiment, I'm my trusty HP set to send a secret message at 600 baud, FSK 3200 hertz to 7400 hertz.
Yeah, sounds right.
And odd parity and 7 bits. And obviously Eric doesn't believe in that. He thinks the 7 bits are going to blow up the machine. So what do we do?
Turn it on and see what happens.
Okay.
Turn it on.
And then we get the current limit.
The paper low light came on.
Oh, that is good.
Paper low came on?
Yeah, it sure did.
Uh-huh.
What things are spinning?
Oh, it did load the paper.
All right, I got to increase the current limit some more because we're not hitting 28.
Okay, so hold on a second.
The take-up reel is picking up.
Let it go. Go for it. Oh, it went out the other way. Okay, keep going. That's it?
Yeah.
Okay, we've got a green light.
I hear it chewing.
It's trying to do something.
Oh, we're hitting a current limit again. So we're going to need more than 3 amps at 28 volts. But
okay.
So far, we're in pretty good shape.
Oh, we can do that. Same thing with more current.
Are we ready?
Okay. Okay, self-test. Paper low. Let's try high power mode.
No change.
That's paper feed.
Oh, does that work? No, the paper doesn't feed. As I expected. Do it again, paper feed. Yeah, so that
because
I sort of expect, yeah. Is the rotor, the drum is not drumming. And it's hard to see the drum, but it's not moving. It's just stationary in there. So we have to find out why the motor is not working. Okay, so hold on.
That makes paper low light up.
And that, it should think it has paper.
Okay, well.
Okay, new motor action. So it seems that this might be stuck. Turn it on. Yes, trying to do something. But then it's definitely hitting. So is it normal? I would suspect not. I would suspect it should be free. Okay, turn it off. And now it's releasing. So it wants to turn it, but it can't. So we might have a mechanical issue. Well, little did I know, not just one mechanical issue, but a whole bunch of mechanical catastrophes are awaiting us, which we'll battle in the next episode in the series. See you then!